George Blaha, and this is the From Glory Days show, which chronicles the lives of professional Detroit athletes following their pro sports careers. Watch the stories unfold as former Detroit Pistons, Tigers, Red Wings, and Lions share their personal stories of struggle and success as they have transitioned from the pinnacle of their pro sports careers back into normal everyday lives. You won't find another show like the From Glory Days show capturing this transition as told directly by the athletes themselves.
Hi, I'm Jeff Ivory, the financial pro featured on the PBS series From Glory Days. Keep an eye out for my financial tip during today's show, and feel free to visit my website for more information and tips on staying financially fit.
Who are we? We're the Volunteers of America. What do we do? Since 1896, we've been serving men, women, children, seniors, and veterans right here in Michigan with shelter, housing, food, and much more. Need help? Want to help? Hello, I'm Kurt David, author of the best-selling book, From Glory Days, and your host of the show. Today's guest grew up in the west side of Michigan before being drafted by the Detroit Tigers. He was selected by the Sporting News as Rookie Pitcher of the Year and eventually won a World Series with the Detroit Tigers in 1984. Let's give a nice warm welcome to our guest, Dave Rozema. Dave, when you first came in the league, you were being compared to another Detroit Tiger pitcher at that time by the name of Mark Fidrich. And there was a quote in the Baseball Digest at that time that said, you stated that, "I'm not the bird because he talks to the ball and I just talk to myself." What kind of thing was Dave Rozema saying to himself at that time?
I think we all have that issue. We all talk to ourselves. I think Bird, like I say, do you want to compare us to back in the day? Well, I'm not him. Mm-hmm. He was unbelievable when he did it, and it was all a true act. I mean, that's the way he pitched. He believed himself. And me, you know, you kind of go, you throw a pitch outside corner and go, I should have done that.
So you were talking to yourself.
You see it going to left field bleachers or something. So you kind of just talk to yourself a little bit, try to get yourself motivated, give yourself a game, a program, where to pitch certain guys, and I just talked to myself.
Yeah, so you're talking to yourself a lot about what to do. Well, let's talk about some of the highlights of your career then. If we were to look back on Dave Rozema's career, what were some of the highlights that you would point out of your career?
Opening day, 77. I had my grandparents, my mom, my brothers, and they called number 19 on the, to run on the baseline, third base side, introduce you, Dave Rozema, your pitcher, blah, blah, blah. And I ran out there, and opening day is a crazy anyway, 52,000 people. Give you a standing O, and cause I had a really good spring training. Then to look up there and see my mom and my grandpa and my grandma, my dad, just like, your hair and your goosebumps, just everything. And my first victory was in Boston against, the Jim Rices and Kario Skrimski and Fisk. I was an 8-0 shutout. So, they were looking for big things of me, but I had 3 no decisions before that. They're going, when's this kid going to get a W or something? So you go into Boston, you get your first W, 8-0 shutout. And then, of course, 84 championship was just unbelievable for the city, for ballplayers. Just being from Michigan, so that was one thing, too, that people don't understand is that I'm born and raised from Grand Rapids, Michigan. Mm-hmm. So I'm a Detroit Tiger fan. I mean, 5 years old, I was LK Line, Willie Horton, and next thing you know, you're playing with the Detroit Tigers. And then next thing you know, you win the World Series. And you're going, thank you, dear Lord.
Yeah. But what honors did you receive? You talked about some of the honors. What were some of the honors that you received personally as a pitcher?
Well, I mean, obviously as a Sporting News Rookie of the Year, mm-hmm. Grand Rapids Hall of Fame.
There we go.
After my career was over. Like you say, 84, the ring, trophies, just being part of a team that did the best. I mean, there's not a lot of main thing. I did a couple All-States in high school. Mm-hmm. Actually, one of the biggest games I've ever pitched in my life was in AA, a one-game playoff for the first division champs versus the second division champs. We were second, and Oakland was the first, and it was a one-game playoff, and we beat them 2-0. Jack Moore's on a team, Lance, Tram. So then we went to We went to Orlando to play for the championship. We won the World Series down there, too. A double World Series guy.
And that's what I've heard. A lot of the guys that I've talked to from that 84 team said you guys grew up together, that you guys spent a lot of time through the minors together. What can you tell us about that?
Well, see, a lot of times it's like, you get good teams now, and they're from everywhere. The pieces of the puzzle. You get this guy, you get this guy, this big free agent, this guy comes in. And back in the day, we had, I mean, Double A, Tram, Whitaker, Brookins, Jack, myself, Lance, Steve Kemp. That was just on one team. Then you got Triple A was Fidrich, Gibby, Leach. You know, all the guys were, we came up not very, making very much money. Mm-hmm. And hard times. I mean, I shouldn't say hard times, but the minor leagues is hard times. I mean, it was tough. Making $500 a month, then that's before taxes.
What made it tough for you? What was the toughest
part? Well, I mean, leaving home. Mm-hmm. I mean, when you're kind of a homebody, you know, you leave home and you're gone for 8 months and you're with different people you've never seen, different towns. You know, mom's not cooking your food in front of you. Ah, where's my breakfast at? You know what? Go get it yourself. And so you grew up at 18 years old. You grew up really fast. No, I didn't go to college. So I you know, graduated high school. And other than that, it was just, it's pretty tough going on your own and surviving. And, you know, is this what I really want to do? I mean, you write letters and I want to come home now. No, do your best. And, you know, and just fight through it. Just do your best and see where you go from there. And you know what? You know, seeing the guys and your teams and the coaches. Jim Leland was my first coach in Double A or Single A in Clinton, Iowa. And, you know, they talk to you. How you feel? You all right? Things going pretty good. I had a bike, no car. Had a bike, so I pedaled, you know, to the ballpark every day.
A pedal bike, not a motorbike.
You're talking about a pedal bike. Yeah. I couldn't afford a pedal. I mean, that's about it. But, you know, you just, you survived.
And you not only grew up together, but you had to grow up quick, it sounds like. Like you said, being on your own, traveling, you learned the hard knocks of baseball at that time.
The hard knocks. And I'll tell you what, you fight for your jobs. I mean, you go to spring training, there's 200 guys. There's four teams. And there's four teams, there's 40 pitchers, and there's 120 pitchers. And now you see, so this is our group right here. All the fans and you were sitting here, eat lunch about the third week in March. Can so-and-so report to whoever's desk? They're gone. Next day, five more. Next day, three more. And you're going, you know, and you're battling for positioning for as far as some guys are probably going, man, I hope he gets bombed tonight. You know, because I pitch pretty good and maybe I can make that team. Mm-hmm. But, you know, like you like you said, you do the best you can. They have their scouts and they, you know, you just, it's what they like. I mean, obviously, if you're throwing hard and you're wild, they want to keep you, but they go, hey, he's going to walk everybody. But now you nitpick and you throw some strikes, you got a little change up. Let's keep this kid, see what happens.
So what made you different at that point? You said the competition was fierce. What made you different?
Well, you know what? I got very lucky one time. In A-ball, they used to bring over guys for batting practice to the big leagues all the time. So they said, you know, this guy throws strikes. So I threw strikes, and bam, 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 bam. I'm going, wow, these guys can hit. Next guy comes in, he'll hit somebody, never ask back. Next guy comes in, he'll hit a little bit wild, hits a guy, never ask back. Let's get that Rozema guy back here again. Did it again. Pretty soon they go, isn't this the guy that just learned to change up? He goes, yeah. He goes, Ben Ogilvie was up. I kind of remember this. Bill Friend's catching. And all of a sudden he puts on a change. I'm going, what? Fastball. Throws a change up. I'm going, looks at me, he goes, gives me the shake. Next thing you know, I throw a change up. He swang. Oh, but I'm a lot of it. He was Dominican or something. He was talking. He goes, what was that? They go, wow, throw that again. So I told him I was throwing it, and he missed it again. And he missed it again. Then I threw him a fastball, and he fouled it off. And I went, click. Bill Fran came out and goes, can you throw that ball there most of the time? I go, yes, I can. He goes, you're going to make a lot of money in this game.
Tell me more about, let's talk about that 84 season, because obviously for Detroit fans, it's a great year. You know, the World Championship there, World Series. What do you remember about that year for Dave Rozema?
You know what? For Dave Rozema, it's being part of the starting rotation. 35-5. I start off 7-1. You know, they had Jack 9-2, and Peaches, it was kind of funny because Jack was 9-2, Peaches was like 8-2. Wilcox was like 7-3, and I was 7-1. I'm going, hey, here's your big boy.
With names like that, yeah.
I'm leading this team to the championship. Mm-hmm. But then I ended up 7-6. So maybe, you go, don't get too cocky.
Yeah, exactly. So.
But it was a camaraderie, the team guys. I mean, we hung around together all the time, went out and ate together, talked baseball, just different things of like, so maybe somebody didn't do something right. Yeah, it's okay, but learn from it. Pitching. I mean, we got Willie, and it was like, well, where'd this guy come from? He's fabulous. Mm-hmm. So, Willie, we had Lopi all the time on our team, but, you know, we just needed that one extra piece of puzzle. When, you know, mm-hmm. bring the piece of puzzle in, Daryl and Willie, basically. And, it was over.
What did that mean to you, that championship that year? What did it mean to you?
It just mean being a part of a great, great team and being from Michigan, part of a just a legacy in Michigan, because they've only 35, 45, 68, 84. They tried this year and they tried in 06, but right. It really takes a lot
absolutely.
Of luck, health, to win these things.
Yeah, and it didn't end for you at 84, though. Things moved on for you as far as your career. Tell us more about that.
I didn't start at the end of the career. I wasn't one of the closers or a starter for Spark in September, and I knew I was going to go free agency. Mm-hmm. They offered me a non-guaranteed contract. So I challenged the free agent market, and I went to Texas for a couple years. And financially, it was the best thing for me. But as far as team-wise, in 84, we started off 35-5. Texas, we started off 6-25.
Ouch.
So totally it was like different. A slap in the face, bunch of old guys, good guys, but just not a winning type of team.
Why did your pro sport career end?
Collusion was involved back in the day, and I think I was mixing it. I had almost 10 years of baseball service in, and they had to bring the younger guys in because people were making with 10 years, I was making good money, and they said, well, you know what? He's 2-4, or 4-2, and he's got an ERA of the mid-3s. Let's get some youth in here, some 21s, 22-year-old kids, and see what they can do. So, that's what they did. And I found myself out of a job and tried to make it in the minor leagues, a few other teams, Chicago White Sox, Atlanta, and Philadelphia. And I stayed in Philadelphia for a couple more years, and I called it quits.
So you tried to hang on as long as you could? And
yeah.
What was the deciding factor? You said you called it quits. What was the deciding
factor?
Well,
I was married in 85, and I wasn't getting a chance because I was actually pitching pretty good. Mm-hmm. I was 4-2 and 4-1, low ERAs. Mm-hmm. And I'm going, do I get a chance? You guys are brutal. I go, I know how to pitch. And they never gave me a chance. And I just said, well, you know what? I had a small child and married my lovely wife. And I said, it's time to go.
Time to step away.
Yeah,
you mentioned
yeah.
about making good money at that time. Athletes take up to a 90% pay cut when they're done playing. Many of them struggle financially and in bankruptcy and everything. What was the biggest challenge for you coming out of pro sports?
Well, it's figuring out what you're going to do. No college background, and so you're limited. But I did have 10 years of major league service and a world champion ring on my finger. So it made it a little bit easier in the sales. And I met a guy I played ball with, and he worked for Fuji's. He was in our minor leagues, went for Fuji's, and he goes, you know, I thought this company is an X-ray company. They're looking for another salesman, and what do you think? I'm going, I don't know anything about that. He goes, you will. So I actually put on a pair of blue pants, shirt with my name on it, and my tennis shoes, got a truck, and I went to work for a year making $9 an hour. And that was a slap in the face. But I said, you know what? It made me think about, you know, okay, this, I got a normal job. I mean, I'm like the other 99% of the people out in America now. So figure it out. It's just what I want to do. And so I did it. I had a good boss, and I ended up selling extra equipment for 15 years.
We're going to take a break right now for an educational minute. But when we come back, more from Dave Rozema and his transition out of pro sports.
The athletes that we highlight on this show talk about and face numerous financial and career transitions as they move away from athletics and celebrity to a more private life. But don't we all face similar challenges? Other than the fact that our athletic abilities may differ, we all are faced with personal financial challenges, and with those challenges come choice. Too often we act too quickly, blindly making choices without first understanding our options. Unfortunately, this is often more detrimental to doing nothing at all, and I see this negative effect all the time. However, if you're looking to make the right decision for yourself during this transition, you want to understand each of your options and how each might impact you. That way, you can avoid making the mistakes that are going to cost you both financially and emotionally. My tip for you is simple. Be prepared. Have a strategy laid out in advance to help you through some of these potential transitions and events, and seek the proper guidance and assistance in areas that are foreign to you.
I'm Kurt David, and we're back with Dave Rozema from the 1984 World Champion Detroit Tigers. Dave, we left off, we want to talk about that transition out of pro sports. In other words, we talked about what some of the things are the reason why you get out of pro sports, but let's talk about the difficult parts of it. What were some of the most difficult parts of that transition?
But one thing professional athletes are, we know how to talk to people. I mean, I do. I'm a people's person. I go up and meet fans and sign autographs and look them in the eye and say thanks for coming to the ball game and stuff like that. So it was easier for me to go out into the real world and go, all right, what do I want to do? Where's an opportunity? Where's an opportunity at? So you kind of go through different things and you find one. Do you like it? Do you like the people around you? What is there something else you want to get into commentating? Do you want to get into this, that? I got into medical sales. So I sold extra equipment for 15 years. And, you know, my first year, I was, like I say, the blue pants, driving a truck around. Matter of fact, the truck would stop in my intersection all the time because it was such an old one. A cop behind me, Rosie, why don't you get another truck? I went, it's not my truck. It's coming. He goes, well, get rid of it. I'm going, you're talking about embarrassing. Hey, Rosie, what are you doing? I'm going to shoot myself. So, you know what? I actually went there and got in the medical field, in the hospitals and doctor's offices. And I literally went from
being a World Series pitcher, you know, being on that team and everything like that, to all of a sudden you're driving a medical truck around and stopping any intersections.
Well, I did take 1 year off. 70, let me see, was it 88? I came on back. Kurt Gibby, he's my brother-in-law right there, and he had a farm. We moved around the country. And he goes, why don't you figure out what you want to do and run my farm? So I took care of 6 horses, plowed, did everyday work for somebody that, you know, needed it, his services.
What was the purpose? I mean, you're going
He needed a ranch manager.
Okay.
So a house manager, basically, because he needed a lot of things done, and he didn't know anybody. So, I mean, I had new driveways put in, pools put in, took care of the horses, did his fields, bought some stuff, you know, hired some employees, that sort of thing. So, and then I figured, okay, my wife said, honey, what? Because I'm too young to be put out to the corn. We got to move back.
So it was good for a while. It was good for transition to have that time to yourself.
It was fun being out in the country. But then I said, you know what? I can always go to the country, but I'm kind of more of a city guy to work-wise because it was our traveling every morning and back home is ridiculous. So I went there and did my thing and survived and just made the best of it. I mean, sometimes it was hard, but I read, I understood, I went on service calls, I had installed. So you get to know the insides of the equipment and the outsides of the equipment, how to fix them, what they do. And sure, that was actually pretty good.
Is this anything you knew before baseball or something you had to learn all over again?
I had nothing. I mean, plus you had to turn things, talk about stories. You know, the processors develop your film, you know, like our knees or whatever. And I leaned over one time to fix the machine. My tie went down the rollers. I'm going, oh! I pulled my tie up out of the machine. And I goes, oh, are you okay? I'm going, man, I've never had that happen before, but it was pretty funny.
No, I'm glad you got out so you can be here today anyway, Dave. So definitely so.
My tongue's coming out.
Well, what do you miss the most? What do you miss the most about baseball?
The competition, grinding it out, you know, using this and figuring out the hitters, you know what I mean? After watching the World Series, just, you know, the last month going, man, I could pitch with these guys. You know, break a ball, boom, keep it down low, sink them away. Do this, like the chess match, basically. Getting prepared, you know, getting prepared for a game. You know, going out there, batting practice, and you know it's your game. You pitch against Guidry, and you go, oh, man, I got to, if I give up 2 runs, I'm going to probably lose. I go, I got to get these guys down and, you know, get yourself a game plan as far as, okay, Reggie Jackson, Chris Chambliss, Randolph, Nettles. You know, you figure them out and, you know, you go and do it.
So it wasn't just the physical part of the game. It was a mental part that you missed as well.
Really,
you know, that chess match, so to speak, as far as trying to
the competition, get ahead. The sweating, the rooting, the fans, runs, excitement. I'm like a big kid.
Have you found anything to replace that?
Golf.
Golf, well.
I like to golf. I like to try to be the best I can. Sports, I like to hunt. You know, the challenge of sitting in a tree and trying to shoot the big buck, they're smart. There's lots more.
Yeah, so you've transcended into, you know, the golf game, trying to be as good at the golf game, hunting, things of that sort as well. Is it the same?
Work, you know, being a good father. It is. It's kind of like yourself. You kind of sit in a tree, you got a lot of thinking, a lot of what to do, situations, figure out what they think, what you think, how you can head them off. Working-wise, getting out there, knocking on doors, making cold calls, talk to people. You know, people they like to meet you. I mean, sometimes you feel like, you know, you're a little bit bashful and you go, knock, knock. Hey, how you doing? You know, you tell them your story, what you're looking for. We're going to do some, say, yeah, some guy, I'll give you a try. So get out there and do the best you can.
I found a lot of pro athletes get into sales afterwards for that reason. It's you can get your door open, get your foot in the door, shake a hand. Maybe a little more difficult getting a contract signed, but certainly gets you in the door to shake a hand and have a conversation anyway.
Well, you know what? A lot of guys do that, but back in the day when I came up, you know, I'm 55 now, it was different then because you entertained a lot and you got paid for it and you got Red Wings, you got Tigers, and you could take them golfing. And now you need to work those laptops and everything's at home. I mean, you have meetings at home. You got to be there. Corporate America is
it's
tough.
Changed even
really
since
tough.
You started as far as that
sure
and everything.
Is. So you got to be on it.
What's the best part about the transition? We talk about the difficulties, you know, the lack of passion or difficulty with finding new passion again. What's the best part of the transition being out of pro baseball?
Old stories, meeting people, looking at pitchers, running some of the old guys, doing Tiger camps. We do the fantasy camp down in Florida every year. It's just great. You see 100 and some guys down there putting Tiger uniforms on, trying to play baseball. it's funny. I mean, they take it so serious. And you talk a little bit, you know, game strategies. And then you see all your old buddies like Dan Petrie and Bergman and some of the old guys and just reminisce and
keeps you connected
time.
To the game then, not just
sure
the games,
does.
But your fans. Because that's one of the things you mentioned about was being connected to the audience and the fans and the people of the community. That was important to you. So when you came out, it wasn't that difficult to do
right.
that.
Right.
How important do you think that is, that made a difference for you coming out, that you were able to do that? How important do you think
well,
that was?
Well, a lot
was?
Of times, you know, when I played, you would not believe what happens in my life right now. Sometimes when I played, I'll get some five-year-old kid, and he'll go, I got your autograph in 1977. He's the head of the bank. Hey, how you doing? You're a doctor. He goes, yeah, I need some equipment. You were really nice to me when I was young. And he goes, I'll give you a chance to quote on some equipment. Really? He goes, he's like 30. I'm 40, you know, right there. And he go, well, you know, being nice
off.
To people paid off.
What successes would you like to highlight right now as far as Dave Rozema, what you're doing now? What some of the highlights would you have for it?
Still living. Mm-hmm. Good to my family.
That's a good start, yeah.
You know, just as far as highlights, I don't know. Be nice to people. Just, you know, it's pretty easy. I don't know. I really don't have a highlight because every day, thank God, every day, you know what I mean? 6 foot up is good.
Yeah, no.
And you have different challenges all the time.
Mm-hmm.
So you kind of like take every day at a time, get your little sketch and book out, write some things out what you want to do, and contact some people and, you know, do the best you can.
Well, we're going to be nice to some people right now because this is one of my favorite parts of the show is we have live studio audience question and answer, and we're going to have some live studio audience question and answer right now.
When a player gets traded, is it hard to not take it personally?
You know, Mark, it's sometimes you don't want to. You got to figure out what's going to do best for that organization. Sometimes you feel hurt, especially if you're in their organization. You got drafted in an organization. You come up from the youngsters all the way up through, and you go, you know, what happened? Why did I get traded for same kind of pitcher, same kind of guy? Could be a personality clash or something, or maybe you're injured, something. But you know, you don't try to take it too defensive. Hopefully you can do the best job you can with that other team.
It's a business. I mean, it's a business.
It's a business.
And that's something you have to realize.
And it always will be a business. And they want to win. And that's the type of the game. We want to see Detroit, I mean, play, you know, Texas want to beat them. I mean, you do everything possible
to get that advantage.
Get to the top. And you know, who can find the right trades or the right pieces of the puzzle?
First of all, Sparky Anderson was such a great, great guy, one of a kind.
Yes,
what words of wisdom did he give you that you still cherish and follow today?
It was actually more special to me as I got older than it was when I was a player. It seemed like when you're a player, you kind of like, you think you know everything. And Sparky just says, you know what, you young boys, I'm going to make you young men. You're going to learn how to respect people. He says, you know, you don't come to play this game for you. You play this game for them.
I was just wondering if you prefer the old traditional stadiums or the new, larger, less intimate corporate stadiums.
I really appreciate my baseball career starting in Detroit in 77 because it was still all green. We probably had one of the coolest scoreboards in professional baseball besides Boston. And I wish sometimes they would take a little bit more of the old style and put it into the new style.
Well, Dave, this show is about transitioning professional athletes, and my question for you is, what advice would you have for anybody that was in transition or facing change and adversity? What advice would you have?
Stay positive within yourself. Everybody, you get nervous, you know, don't freak out. Things will happen for a good reason. Say your prayers. you know what, though? Like, I worked in this job, and there was this book out there called Who Moved My Cheese? I mean, everybody, I don't know if you read it or not, but if you had to change careers, it's like either you get with it or you sit here and you starve because the cheese is going to eventually go away. And unless you want to motivate and go with it and do something different and stay motivated, be happy, smile, laugh, keep in contact with your family, constant people in your family.
So great advice from Dave Rozema. Unfortunately, our time is up today. I'm Kurt David, and this wraps up another show. I'd like to thank our guest, Dave Rozema, for joining us.
Thank you, Kurt.
Please join us next time when we watch the stories of professional athletes unfold from Glory Days.
Hi again. I'm Jeff Ivory, and I hope you enjoyed today's show and the educational minute I shared with you. If you'd like more information on staying financially fit through your life's transitions, please visit the website, www.jwifinancial.com.
Who are we? We're the Volunteers of America. What do we do? Since 1896, we've been serving men, women, children, seniors, and veterans right here in Michigan with shelter, housing, food, and much more. Need help? Want to help?